It is a wonderful job that you are doing. Yeah, I'll share my screen. Yeah, is it visible now?
Yes, we can see it just fine.
Okay. So, this is my introduction. I'm in PhD in Environmental Science and Technology. And today I will speak on Indian remote sensing satellites, Chandrayaan and Mangalyaan. This is about myself a little bit, how I was working in the Vindhyan Highlands, which are a part of India, in northern India. They are forest, dry tropical forest, and this is the National Remote Sensing Center, where I learned about remote sensing satellites and did my PhD there. And here I'm some of my students where I usually go and teach in India. So let's start with some questions about satellites. Please feel free to ask anything in chat. What is the natural satellite of the Earth? What are the artificial satellites? How many of them are there and what they are made up of?
Let's give them a minute. Don't move to your slide yet. Yes, of course. Moon is the natural satellite. And let's give them one more minute. So, because it takes some time to type in chat.
Yeah.
So,
the moon, very good. Someone said that the moon is the natural satellite of the Earth.
So, Manishwar says the moon. Anjali says the moon, yes.
Yes.
So, what are the artificial satellites? How are they different? And how many of them are there? Take a guess. And what are they made of? Let's give them one more minute again.
Okay.
So, yes, man-made, mostly metal objects, right. How many of them are there? Any ideas? They take some time. So, we'll give them one more minute. Because, again, typing takes time.
Yeah.
So, Anjali says artificial satellites use solar energy to power them. Some of them do. Yes, not all of them. And they're being launched all the time. I see what you're saying. So, Quinn says 10,001.
My God.
Okay, I guess we can move on.
Yes. So, moon is the natural satellite of the Earth. I think most of you know by this. And next, what we'll learn more about is the artificial satellites. Artificial satellites are man-made satellites and they differ from the natural satellite. Why? Because natural satellite, we have only one and that is moon. Artificial satellites, we have many. So it is deliberately sent into orbit in space for us to send, receive, or bounce back information in different areas of the Earth. So that is the role of the artificial satellite. And moon, it has a different role, which we'll learn about it in the coming slides. So what does a satellite consist of? There are two main components of an artificial satellite. One is the antenna to send and receive the information, and a power source such as solar panel or battery. Yes, some of the kids had said there is a solar panel or battery. See here, this is what it is attached. Here are the solar panels and they charge the battery when they go out into the space. They get energy from the sun. And then here is the antenna control. And then this is the communications. And this is the body wherein all other instruments are there. So you see, this is a brief diagram or a figure of satellite. Then what is the speed of the satellite? The speed of a satellite must travel to stay in space, and this is called the orbital velocity. The orbital velocity of the satellite depends on its altitude above the Earth. The nearer the Earth, the faster the required orbital velocity. So at an altitude of 124 miles, which is 200 kilometers, it needs to be about 17,500 miles per hour. So that is what the speed with which it rotates around the Earth. So it in order to stay it in orbit, it needs that much amount of velocity. So now again, some questions to you. What was the first artificial satellite and who was the first live creature in space? Any idea?
Again, take a couple of minutes to answer. Mm. And for you, Dr. Lakshmi, while they're answering, they have a question to you. What are the instruments on the satellite and what are they measuring? I guess you're going to talk about it bit later, right?
Yes.
So
there's a wide range of instruments, and it depends upon the purpose of each satellite. So each satellite has a different combination of instruments.
So you're getting some answers here.
Yes.
The answers are ranging from an octopus, Dr. Lakshmi, a monkey, to a dog or rat.
Dog, rat.
Yeah. Oh my God. You see the chat, right? So
the rat is too small, no? It will just hide somewhere and bit all the parts, I guess. That is the nature of a rat.
Yeah, rat is probably... Well, you could imagine a small satellite with a rat, I think. I don't know, actually, why they decided on a dog instead of a rat. It's actually a good question. I don't know. Rat would work.
It's someone nearer to mammal, we can say.
They probably wanted something closer to a human being.
Intelligent also. Dogs are trained for various things. So I think dog is a better example.
They needed something closer to a human being in terms of mass, I think.
And something
we can actually train well. Okay, so... Sputnik was the first artificial satellite, that's right, so we can move on.
So Sputnik was the world's first artificial satellite launched by the Soviet Union in 1957, and that started the space age. Then it weighed around 86.6 kg and it circled the Earth every 96 minutes. And remained in orbit till January 1958. After that, it fell and burned in the Earth's atmosphere. And after this following, there was Sputnik 2 and Sputnik 3 also. So Sputnik 2, it gave Laika the opportunity to go into the space. So this is a figure of Sputnik 1, how it looked like. Since it was the first satellite, so it was very crude. It was in the form of a sphere. 23 inches in diameter, and inside it was filled with nitrogen gas so that it could travel. And then it had four radio antennas, two radio transmitters within the sphere, and a distinctive would broadcast a distinctive beep beep sound that was picked up all over the world. Silver zinc batteries were powered the transmitter for 22 days before giving out. So you see, technology-wise, it was very crude. With whatever resources they had at that time, this was the best thing they could do. And here, this was Laika, the stray dog found on the streets of Moscow. And it was fitted into this Sputnik 2 with belts and all, so that it could hardly move. It could move only little, just here and there. And then it lived for a few hours in the orbit. So how did Laika survive in space? Any idea? It is a dog, it needs to eat, it needs to do everything. So how will it survive? Suppose if someone is tied to belts and hooks and everything. Any idea, children?
Let's give them a minute or two. So Laika was the first living organism in space. Oh, so Anjali thinks because she only survived for a few hours.
In space, and this is a small creature. So still,
Laika, yeah, sorry.
Yeah.
Laika still needed to eat and drink and pee, right?
Mm.
So Queen thinks that radiation killed it. Yes, it was pressurized.
See, there is a lot of pressure and it is some out of the Earth's atmosphere. And you have to survive the rotation and other so many other things there, which are quite different what we have on Earth. So it would have been difficult, but still all the mechanisms, they helped her to survive for some hours. Yeah, some have got good answers. So it was, the arrangement was made in such a way that they could feed her and they could remove the waste from her body and they could monitor her. But still it only made her live for some hours.
Yes, so they found out the ways to feed her through the tubes and help her to breathe and so on. But since it was just the first time for a living thing on orbit, the dog didn't survive quite long, for a long time. So just for a few hours. Okay, I think we can move on.
Yeah, so the internal atmosphere in the spacecraft was provided by a carbon dioxide absorbing device, an oxygen generator, an oxygen regulator, and a fan that activated when the cabin temperature went above 15 degrees centigrade. The food and water were injected by tube directly into the stomach in jelly form, and waste were removed by another implanted tube. A crude television monitor allowed her movements in the cabin to be seen. So you see, it needed oxygen to survive, and then food and water it needed, which were injected, and then there was a television to monitor her movements in the cabin. Okay? So now, again, some questions. How many satellites are there in orbit, and which countries have most number of satellites?
Make a guess.
Yes.
Again, let's give them a minute. I remember Queen already guessed it was 10,001, right, Queen? Mm. So any other suggestions there? So Queen thinks maybe US and Russia has the most. So
yes.
Thousands, Declan says.
Yeah, thousands are there, yes.
I think Manishwar agrees. I don't know with which part. US, yes. Russia, or... Oh, US, Russia. Mm.
Yes. Some answers we are quite near.
Okay, let's move on.
So currently there are 4,994 satellites in orbit. Seven of them are in orbit around the celestial bodies other than the Earth. And meaning that means only 4,887 satellites are around our heads every single day. And out of these, active are only 1,957 satellites. And then there are three countries, USA, China, and Russia, which have the most number of satellites in space. I think someone said USA and Russia, missed out China. China is also stands number second. Then India stands seventh in this list. So you are going to hear more about the Indian satellites and how India is doing in this space world. So this is one example of the world's lightest satellite, which is in orbit. And it is made by, it is named as KalamSat. It is named after Dr. Kalam, who is the missile man of India and was also the former president of India. So it is made by a student who was a class 12 student. I think his name is Rifat Sharuk. He was 18-year-old student. And see here, it is named after former president APJ Abdul Kalam. And this is the first ever 3D printed satellite in the world. And this is first satellite to be built by a private Indian firm. And the best part of this, it is into orbit. And it is using the fourth stage of the rocket as an orbital platform. See, this is so small, if you leave it out, it will not go. But it is using the fourth stage of the rocket to use at an orbital platform. So this is first time this technique is being tested also. That how it will function if we allow the fourth stage. Usually the fourth stage becomes dormant after its work is over and it becomes static. But then to utilize that also, they have proposed this for this satellite. So it is 1.2 kg and its lifespan is 2 months and research time 6 years. And the cost it took is 12 lakhs rupees. So isn't it wonderful? You can also think of some small satellites.
There was a quick question, Dr. Lakshmi. What is a lakh?
What is? Lakh is rupees. You can say 100,000. 100,000 rupees. So 1 rupee at present, I think $1 is equal to 70 rupees. Approximately. Just 1 or 2 points up and down are there. Always. So approximately right now it is 70 Indian rupees is equal to $1.
Thank you. We are learning some interesting facts about India's currency here. Thank you.
So this is about the remote sensing satellites, Indian remote sensing satellites, some interesting facts. See, these are the satellites. This is the receiving station. So it looks like this. So they send signals and this is the receiving station. And from here you receive the signals and then decipher it. So to begin with, first introduction is about the electromagnetic spectrum. So this is the visible light which we see. And here is the ultraviolet, X-rays and gamma rays towards the left of the visible light and infrared, radar, FM, etc. So what the remote sensing satellites, they work in these areas, infrared, visible light, radar, FM, etc. There are various types of satellites which work in different ranges and for different purposes. So they capture their light energy and transform into the images. And those images are deciphered by the scientist and then it is put into use. So this is the cycle. So now let me explain more. See, sun is the major source of solar radiation. And we see on the land, so many things, buildings, huts, paved road, water, bare soil, grass, trees, all sorts of things. So when the sun's rays are incident on these, it is definitely, some will be reflected. Some are absorbed also. Depending upon the material, structure, everything, some are absorbed, some are reflected. So the satellites make use of this reflected solar radiation and then they make use of this and they capture the energy and that is transformed into the images. And then the receiving station, which I showed you earlier, that receives the signals and the computer stores the signals and they form different images. Those images are interpreted by the scientist. So I hope you can understand how from the sun, the satellites capture the images. Then there are two types of satellites which are kept into orbit. So one is polar orbit satellites, which orbit the Earth in north-south direction from pole to pole. So as the Earth spins underneath these satellites, they scan the entire globe strip by strip. So strip by strip means how do you put a bandage? You put a strip bandage onto you like this, like this, like this. No. So in strips, scans the Earth and it captures the features like that. So this is called sun synchronous. And it is kept at a position which is relative to the sun. And at every time, particular time, it scans a particular part of the Earth. Like suppose if it is 10 a.m. at New York, definitely next day also 10 a.m. it will scan the same part. So it is in that type of mode, in that mode. So this helps for the weather satellites, like today it is hot, tomorrow 1 degree, 2 degree less or more. So this helps the weather satellites to help us learn more about how it is changing every day. Then this is the geostationary satellite. This is a this type of satellites orbits the Earth from west to east over the equator. It moves in the same direction and speed as the Earth is spinning. Therefore, from Earth, these satellites don't appear to be moving. That is what we say. See, that is what it is in the west to east direction. And since it is synchronous with the Earth, for us, it will we'll feel that it is there at the same time, same place. So these types are useful for communication satellites, which we need every day. So now this is India's first satellite. I hope you'll understand this. So in the 1970s, India took a giant leap into space with the launch of its first satellite, Aryabhatta. Named after the famous ancient Indian astronomer, the satellite weighed 360 kg at the time of its launch. See, this is another crude, very crude, as early as 1970s. So this is in the form of a hexagonal shape, and all these are solar panels. Inside are the cameras. All these are solar panels which will activate the batteries. And this is the photograph of Aryabhatta. He was a great astronomer of ancient India. Ancient India, the teachers used to look like this, and you'll learn more about him. He was the earliest known mathematician and astronomer of India. Aryabhatta was aware that the Earth rotates on its axis, and the Earth rotates around the Sun, and the Moon moves around the Earth. He discovered the positions of the nine planets and related them to their rotation around the Sun. He also knew about the eclipse of the Sun, Moon, day and night, Earth contours, and 365 days at the exact length of the year. Aryabhatta also revealed that the circumference of the Earth is 39,968 kilometers. So all these ancient mathematicians, they had given all these things, but we came to realize it quite later. And then I think we can give the credit to Aryabhatta for initiating or giving us the knowledge long before even we really came to know. There were many experiments after this. Many scientists from all over the world had done to prove all these things, which he had done it quite early. Then again, Bhaskara 1 also was launched by the Soviet rocket into orbit in June 1970. It carried a TV camera for taking the picture of the Earth's surface. Besides, it carried microwave radiometer and instrument to study the Earth. Then a similar satellite, Bhaskara 2, was also launched. Another by the Soviet Union again. So this is the photograph of Bhaskara 2. So they lived quite long back, and this Aryabhatta didn't stay for long. So it didn't hinder the Indian scientists. So soon after that, Bhaskara 1 and Bhaskara 2 were launched. And all these three satellites were intended to study the Earth's atmosphere, ionosphere. And they had, see, it was a TV camera for taking the picture of the Earth's surface. So it's still, you can say, it is a very crude form. It had a microwave or radiometer to study the Earth. They were all named after the ancient astronomers. And so the government of India, you know, to honor them, the honor these satellites, it has printed on the 2 rupee note. And this is the postal stamp. See, this is the postal stamp, and this side is the 2 rupee Indian note. So we can always see, whenever we have a 2 rupee note, we can always remember Aryabhatta. And this is the postal stamp. Now, postal stamps are quite out of date. We hardly use, but still, this is to honor this thing. Now we come to Indian remote sensing satellites for monitoring and management of the natural resources and in disaster management. So the satellites, they take pictures of the Earth. By now you must have understood. So what do these pictures help us? These pictures help us to study agriculture, land and water, forestry, environment. See here, if we get the pictures of agriculture, we can predict when and how they will get ready. And then the water, is it causing any problem? Floods, earthquake, drought, landslide, these are natural disasters. And this is the natural resources. Forest also, we can study the health of the forest. We can study how land and water are there. And we can study the environment and agriculture. And this is the natural, these are the disasters. Floods, how it was like before floods, how it will be like after floods, and earthquake, what all it has damaged, drought, how much area is getting into drought, landslide, what areas are affected, and how we can help them to get back soon. So all these disaster management units, or even the ministry or the government, even if they want to help, they will know exactly which area to help and how much to invest in that. I see here some chat. Any questions?
So let's give people a couple of minutes to ask questions. But yeah. I think this is extremely important what you're saying right now, because people usually know that satellites are useful for, you know, for TV, for internet, for this type of stuff, but for weather forecast, of course, but not that many people think about how satellites actually help with disaster management or with agriculture or forestry.
Yes, yes.
And given...
just 2 days back, have you heard about that Beirut explosion, children? Beirut, Lebanon.
Yes, it was recent, just a few days ago. Have you heard of that?
Immediately on top priority, Maxar has released the images. So we can see the extent of damage, and it will help the government to get back soon. You know, instead of wasting time, on land you can't see many things. So if you take a picture from above, it is something different.
Yes, Quinn, you're absolutely right. For example, you can see if the forest is damaged by either by people or by fires or by insects.
Yeah.
You can see
in forest area, in how much area is forested. That is okay. You can see how much logging is there, how many illegal things are going on if you want to protect the forest, and how many have the permission, what exactly is happening inside forest. And it is, whether it is deforested or whether there is a fire. Right now, I think California, Australia, you have heard of the forest fires? Yeah. So forest fire is very dangerous. It will wipe away the forest. So where to go and help the forest fire people, or how to stop the forest fire? In that case, you will get all those information from these images. So, and 1 lakh is equal to 100,000 rupees, not 1,000 rupees. Okay. So this is a map of India, and this the major institute, which is known as Indian Space Research Organization, which comes under Department of Space, is located in Bangalore city of Karnataka state. See, this is the map of India, and we have some 29 states. So Karnataka state is here, and here is the capital, Bangalore, wherein this ISRO is located. And in the same city, we have this ISRO satellite center, which builds Indian satellites. The famous Chandrayaan 1 spacecraft moon was built here. So this is the state, and this is the city where the major institutes are located. And this is the country map. We have several states, just like your country, whichever country you belong to. So there are 29 states. This is South India, and this is the North India. And here only the Western Ghats are there, Eastern Ghats are there, Himalayas are there. Mount Everest is here somewhere, okay? So I hope you have heard all these things. These are the major geographic features. And this is the Deccan Plateau, which is surrounded on all three sides. Deccan Peninsula, Deccan Plateau is here. On all three sides are oceans. Here is the Arabian Sea, here is the Bay of Bengal, and here is the Indian Ocean. And then we come here to INSAT, Indian National Satellite, which is a communication satellite. So this was launched as a series, and the purpose of this was telecommunication. Besides telecommunication, telemedicine, teleeducation, mobile, radio, etc. And it has also connected various villages also, and now, and we are using, after INSAT 1A, there have many series which have come, 1B, 1C, 1D, etc. And after that, the telecommunication department has become very easy for us. And it helps for the weather also. And a special mention is about GSAT or EduSAT. EduSAT is education satellite. One satellite has completely been devoted for education network. So the EduSAT connects all people from remote areas like hilly regions or villages where access is very difficult or terrain is very difficult. So there we, this satellite has helped to study, and especially in this corona times, it has helped us to study. Yes, some of you have guessed it right. Yes, it is very important. And especially in COVID times, this has become a boon for many students who are in remote villages, hilly areas, mountainous areas, where it is very difficult and very difficult for it, especially education purpose. So this is how the children are enjoying. But this is pre-COVID, not post-COVID. These pictures are from pre-COVID, where the children are enjoying this EduSAT education. So lectures are given on this, and they can watch on a TV or a laptop. And in some cases in villages, that projector is arranged. And you know, electricity is a little bit problem. So they have a generator or something as a backup, and that they use on a very big projector screen where the whole village can sit and watch. So these are some of the heroes of our space mission, space program in India. He is Dr. Vikram Sarabhai, father of the Indian space program. And he dreamt a lot, and he initiated all the institutes in India. And then Professor Yashpal, he was a very good science communicator. And Dr. Satish Dhawan, after him, one of the institutes of ISRO has been named Satish Dhawan Space Research Institute at Sriharikota, from where all the satellites are launched. That is the launching area of our missions. Dr. U.R. Rao, who has been the ex-chairman of ISRO, and Dr. APJ Abul Kalam, missile man or rocket man of India, and former president of India. So these are the heroes whom we always keep in mind and think about our space missions. They have initiated, and a lot of development has taken place under their guidance. But unfortunately, none of them are alive today. So it is a yes thing. Yeah, someone has asked. How do you think a rocket man becoming a president of India? Any guesses?
That is so great to have a scientist as a president of a country. This is amazing.
He was a very simple human being. Even though he was a president, he used to do all the work himself, and still his quest for science was nothing less. Yes, of course, under his regime, we are all very happy. And I too had a couple of times met him, but before he became the president, I met him. So it is very great remembrance of him. And then Professor Dr. U.R. Rao and Professor Yashpal, I heard their lectures when I was in as a child. So after hearing their lectures, you know, I got the inspiration to do something like this. So anyway, destiny had brought me, since I inspired to become like them. And later on, I came to know about Dr. Satish Dhawan when I was there at Hyderabad. And it was in 1999, after his death, one of the space institutes were renamed after him, that is at Sriharikota. And Dr. Vikram Sarabhai, Vikram Sarabhai Space Center at Kerala, Thiruvananthapuram. It is there, and it seems he had struggled a lot to build that space center, which is the first in India. So now we come to Chandrayaan, India's first scientific mission to Moon. So what does Chandrayaan mean? Guesses?
Try to guess the meaning of a word without knowing Sanskrit or Hindi.
Okay.
Let's give them a minute to guess.
Maybe. Okay, shall I tell you?
One more minute, let people guess. Something to do with the moon, right? Right.
Yeah, good. Yes. Chandra means moon in Hindi. Hindi is the national language of India. And Yaan means vehicle, to carry in vehicle. So to carry that satellite or space probe, one vehicle was needed. So that is why it is called Chandrayaan, going to the moon. So the mission of Chandrayaan, it was launched in October 2008, and using the Polar Satellite Launch Vehicle, which took it to the moon. The satellite had more than 3,400 orbits around the moon, and the mission was concluded when the communication with the spacecraft was lost on 29th August 2009. And the greatest achievement, after being for around a year, I think it was to discover water on moon. So now we learn how it discovered water on moon and what was the science behind it. So this is the figure of Chandrayaan, how it looks. Solar panels are there. Then this is the X-ray payload, star sensors, imaging payload, then the data transmission antenna, and the fuel tank. This is the basic, how it looks. And then mission of Chandrayaan. It collected massive amount of scientific information, including pictures. The primary science objective was to prepare a three-dimensional atlas of both near and far side of the moon, to conduct chemical and mineralogical mapping of the entire lunar surface with high spatial resolution. But along this, scientists were able to sense the height and depth of various features on the lunar surface. Thus, it became a symbol of India's success in space. And then the most significant result was the discovery of presence of water molecules on the lunar surface. How many of you think the surface of the moon looks like when you see from Earth? I think many of them guess there must be a teddy bear or some image, isn't it? Sometimes you feel like as if the moon is smiling, etc., etc., isn't it? But the surface of the moon is very rough. It has dust on it, and it is dry, total dry. So the Chandrayaan, it succeeded to a certain extent in giving us pictures, and most important, it has given a clue that there is water on the surface of moon. So here you see the infrared reflectance. Earlier I had told you, when the reflected rays go back to the satellite, they capture that. So in this case also, this is the moon mineralogy mapper on Chandrayaan. And this mapped the reflectance. So here, this is with the general picture. And after it has been processed, see the water here. This is the presence of water in this surface only. These are rocks or dust there on the moon. And the water is trapped inside the dust. So it is not as like in seas or lakes, what we see here. It is trapped inside the dust and the rocks or craters, what you call, because there are some rocks of a nature which capture oxygen or water molecules and keep it like that. So this is the blue part. You can see that the dust or the surface which has captured water and kept there. So there was a second instrument on board, that was Lunar Orbiter, which confirmed how the water is being produced. see, earlier I told you that there are several cameras or several instruments. So in this Chandrayaan, by now, how many instruments we have come to know? This is one moon mineralogy mapper. Then second one here, lunar orbiter. And then the third one is the SARA, sub-KV atom reflecting analyzer instrument of European Space Agency. It had given ISRO to be a part of the Chandrayaan 1 mission and confirmed the finding of M3, that is the moon mineralogy mapper, that solar hydrogen nuclei are indeed being absorbed by the lunar regolith, which is a loose collection of irregular dust grains on the lunar surface, which is known as regolith. So however, SARA data showed that not every proton is absorbed. One out of every five rebounces into space. And in the process, the protons join with the electron to become an atom of hydrogen. The moon acts like a big sponge that absorbs electrically charged particles given out by the sun. The particles interact with the oxygen present in some dust grains on the lunar surface, producing water. So moon does not have its own water. It makes use of the hydrogen atoms coming from the sun because it acts like a big sponge. And then the oxygen present in some dust grains, it interacts with that, forms water molecules, and they are trapped there only. It is not flowing like lakes or rivers or oceans. So they are trapped inside the dust grains. So this is the figure of what I have explained now. Yes, I see something here. Yes, the sun supplies the hydrogen and the moon supplies the oxygen. And then they form the water. Water ice, mostly you can call it as water ice. So this is the figure of what I have explained previously slide. Here is the hydrogen flux, you can see. So the moon acts as a mirror also. Whatever hydrogen it receives from the sun, it is reflected back in the same straight line, just as photons. See here, you can see, and they are not deviated because the moon has a very weak gravity and weak magnetic field also. In other cases, it would have deflected and then it would be very difficult. So now you see it is getting deflected straight. So how will this help us? This will help us in mapping hydrogen on the surface of the moon. So since it is coming straight, you can go back straight and you can map hydrogen. So wherever hydrogen is more, you can see the brightness, and wherever it is low, you can see this thing. It is low. So when you map the hydrogen on the surface, you can make an image of it, and then you can predict at what places you can find more water. So more hydrogen, more likelihood of water. Isn't it? So it is something like that of a remote sensing image only it is. It will give us an image where it is high and where it is low. And then we can target those areas and find out, okay, next time we can send a probe here to find more what it is. Isn't it? So this becomes more helpful for us. So again, this is one of the craters. Moon has a lot of craters and captures ice on it, water ice in it. So this is one of the Bulaidlis crater. And just with the naked eye, you can see wherever it is bright, 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 you can guess there must be some water. See here, here, here. The central part of this crater is known to contain more water molecules relative to the surrounding. So all these images give us a very brief description exactly where to look and how to look. So our next missions will be trained on the experience of these missions. Then again, we had Chandrayaan 2, which had a mission to study the lunar topography, mineralogy, lunar exosphere, and the signature of water. But something happened. And Chandrayaan 2 could not reach the surface of the moon. I think last year in September, early September, it was about to land. But then just 2 kilometers from the surface, it lost connection with the base and it had a very hard landing. So hard landing made the Vigyan rover it got out of way, and so we couldn't establish the connection. So it was a failure, but we could reach to that extent, and it took quite some time and quite a lot of effort also. So the lander is known as Vikram, which is named after Dr. Vikram Sarabhai. I had shown you in the earlier slides, the father of the Indian space program. It was designed to function for one lunar day, which is equal to 14 Earth years. And then the rover, this is the six-wheeled robotic vehicle known as Pragnan, which means wisdom in Sanskrit. Sanskrit is also one of the ancient Indian languages. So many terms are based on that. Many terminology which we name many satellites are based on that. So we learn from this failure and we'll proceed again. Next, any questions about Chandrayaan? Now Chandrayaan 3, we are planning maybe in a couple of years, 2022, we'll have Chandrayaan 2. One lunar day is equal to. Okay, one lunar day is equal to 14 Earth days, not years. Okay, sorry. So next we are going to, what does Mangalyaan mean? Any guesses? Again, there is one Hindi word, Mangal.
Yeah. Now they know what Yan is. So we got, no, not Sun and Jelly. But we know that Yan is, yes, something vehicle, Mars. Yes, that's right. So Mars and yes. Vehicle.
Mm-hmm. Vehicle and Mars. And Mars, I think, also is named one god of wisdom in Greek, I think it means. And Mangal means Mars in Hindi. For Mars, the term we use in Hindi is Mangal. And Mangal also means prosperity in Hindi. So Mangalyaan, that is a vehicle sent to the Mars. So Mars is a red planet. What all you know about Mars? Mars is a red planet, hot planet, and anything else? Why does it look red? Yes, yes, very good. Yes. It has got this iron oxide in its dust, and many sandstorms are also there. So that is why it looks red. So mainly it is because of the iron oxide. Iron, as you all know, when it rusts, how does it look? It looks red only, no? So that is the thing behind it. Yes. Yes, let's see what Mangalyaan has found out on the satellite of Mars. And so Mangal means Mars planet in Hindi. Yaan means vehicle in Hindi. So the Mars orbiter mission, or if you short form it is MOM, or Mangalyaan, is a space probe launched by the Indian Space Research Organization on November 5, 2013. Then its mission was to study the atmosphere of Mars, to explore the surface of Mars, mineralogy, morphology, and atmosphere, to search for methane on Martian atmosphere. So giving clue to existence of life. So let us see. And these are the great women behind the Mangalyaan and Chandrayaan. This is Ms. Anuradha TK. She is the senior most lady scientist at ISRO, over 30 years of experience. Ms. Nandini Harina, she has about 2 decades of experience, and they were associated with Mangalyaan. And here Muttaya, Vanita, and Ritu Karidhai, they are associated with Chandrayaan 2. And she has been also working for long in ISRO. And Ritu Karda also has 2 decades of experience in ISRO. She is an aerospace engineer, and they all have dreamt and they all have done it for India. So she is associated with Chandrayaan as well as Mangalyaan. So here you see, this is in honor of Ritu Kardhar. She dreamt of being an aerospace engineer and doing something. So this GIF is in as a mark of respect for her. So you all can be inspired. If you all can get inspiration from her, it is very good. Nothing is impossible on earth. Okay, if you dream, you can. So, did life exist in the past, or there is a possibility of life? This Mangalyaan mission was the cheapest so far in space history. It cost just around $74,000. So, I think so, of all the missions, including NASA or this India or any other country, this is the cheapest which has cost. Why it is cost cheapest? Any idea? Yes. Yes. Because we used all indigenous materials, homemade, all instruments or whatever inputs were given were all homemade. So that made the cost quite less. So that is behind. So definitely if you use your own parts or something, none of the parts were exported or brought from any other place. So that is what made it made quite cheap. First image of Mars taken by the Mars color camera, a 3D view. Again, so many satellites have gone. They have different instruments. So now in Mangalyaan, we come with Mars color camera or MCC. This is the full view of Mars satellite. You can see quite red, definitely the dust and the dust storms. This is the global view. And over the years, MCC has captured over 980 images that were released to the public. They were released in public domain for analysis, and a lot of papers have also come up. Then this is the Mars Exospheric Neutral Composition Analyzer. See, again, this is another analyzer on Mangalyaan, which measured the atmospheric composition at different altitudes, measured carbon dioxide, oxygen, nitrogen, and carbon monoxide. See how they were distributed at different altitudes. So they, in order to study the atmospheric composition at different altitudes, it is necessary that you know how much amount of each gas is there. So you see, it is mostly carbon dioxide, oxygen, nitrogen, carbon monoxide. And oxygen is there, but quite little, not very sufficient. So next here, there are a lot of craters on the surface of Mars. And why do we need to study all those things? So whenever we come back to the craters. So because craters, you know, they capture most of the information. And after studying those craters, you can tell what was the atmosphere when these craters were formed and what all they have preserved, like rocks, dust, or samples, whatever inside is there. The age history of planetary surfaces, the nature of its interior can be assessed, specifics of each impact, time of the impact. So after calculating all these things, we get to know what is the what type of life existed that time, or what all they have experienced during these years. So all these will help us to know what type of life it will support. So these are examples. These are 3 linked craters on Mars. See, here's the big one, the second, and the smallest one. And this is the Tyrrhenian Quadrangle of Mars. See here, you can see the small, small dots you see are small craters. The bigger ones are the bigger craters. And this will also is one of the famous Bakusian. It is located in the heavily cratered southern highlands of Mars. It is supposed to be one of the largest craters on Mars. So it is necessary that we study about the craters. And see, on Moon, the craters had captured water ice. Here also something like that we'll find around the craters only. So whatever information we get is around the craters. Now again, you see here, this is about the Olympus Mons, a major volcanic mountain in the Tharsis region on Mars and is the tallest planetary mountain in the entire solar system. The arrows show here, this is the height at 21 kilometers, and this is the Olympus Mons water ice clouds. The white, bright white patches in the lower left part of the image show water ice clouds aligned along the northwest direction all over the Olympus Mons. So here again, you see that water is existing in the form of water ice clouds. So this again has told us that there is water on Mars, but is it enough for us? No, but it is not enough because it is in the form of crystals, ice clouds. So what we need is a lot of water, and whether that water is drinking for good for drinking purpose or not, all those things are to be studied further. Then this is just as the Aryabhatta satellite, this has completed 4 years till 2018, but till 2019 September, Dr. K. Sivan had told that it's still in orbit, and for one more year it will be there. It is expected to be there. And this is on 2000 rupee note that this figure is there for us to remember. And another mission of Mars or Mangalyaan 2 is expected in 2024. Then here are the signs of life on Mars. The presence of methane on Mars was discovered by methane sensor. See here, methane sensor, it senses methane on Mars. This is again another sensor. And though it is not an absolute indicator, but it does provide a hint. It gives us stronger that there are possibilities. So how does methane come? It comes from animals and plants or any microbial activity which are underwater. So definitely, some sort of animal or plant material must have been there that has decayed and that is giving out methane. So this is a clue which has given us that there might be some sort of life. But then again, is it necessary? I mean, is it strong enough to support greater, presence of life, big animals, big plants or something? No, still there are some microbes only which are present there. Yes.
Right, methane is
yes,
by cows. Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. So for Mars, study Mars, other countries are there, like Emirates Mars Mission. For this, UAE has launched just in last month, 19 July. And then NASA's Perseverance, I hope you all know, it has been also recently launched. And both are on their way to Mars to give us more information. So summarizing, what is the difference between natural satellite and artificial satellite? We have learned, how did the first satellites look like? Indian remote sensing satellites, communication satellite, and EDUSAT. See, all these satellites, Indian remote sensing, communication, and EDUSAT help our life, make it easier, even though in remote areas or wherever place we are. Chandrayaan, it discovered water on the surface of Moon. Mangalyaan, it discovered craters and methane on the Mars surface. So this is all what I summarized for today's thing. And then Moon has evidence of water. Is it enough for human habitation? And Mars has evidence of methane, probably suitable for microbial life. Will humans ever dream to live on Mars? If you had to choose between Mars and Moon, where would you like to go? Yes. Children?
Yeah, you can try to guess and answer in chat. And while you do, I wanted to actually thank you, Dr. Lakshmi. This was a very interesting lecture, and we learned not only about the Indian space mission, we also learned a little bit about Indian history, about the history of Indian space program. We learned several words in Hindi. We saw, you know, some Indian money as well. So that was very, very educational. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Julia. And it was wonderful interacting with the children also. Very good children. Thank you for listening with so much of patience. I hope you gained something from today's thing. And you can always ask questions and answers whenever you are free. And whenever you feel like, I see many people quite interesting. And in chat also, you had all given very good questions.